So in editing part three, it ran a bit long and I couldn't figure out how to bring it down to 15 minutes without leaving out some important sections. So I chopped it in half. And so part three is being presented as two separate parts, and I'll just label them part 3A and part 3B. So part 3A is coming now. Hello and welcome back to my shop. My name is George and I'm coming to you from Chelsea, Quebec. Today is going to be part three of a series on making an LED lamp. In the first two parts, I talked about the electronics. In this third part, I'll talk about the bent wood lamination. So this is the part of the lamp that's going to house the LEDs along with some wires joining the LEDs to some circuitry that's going to be in the base. Okay, there are several good ways of cutting thin strips using either a table saw or a bandsaw, and I'll show you the method that I use. The jig was shown to us by Jack Forsberg at one of the Ottawa Woodworkers Association meetings. Now, before getting to the jig, I'll just mention that Jack Forsberg runs an annual Rust Junkie Fest. If you're interested at all in high-end woodworking machines, you might want to take a look at his Rust Junkie Fest. Here's a jig for getting thin slices, thin sections that you may have not seen before. It's fixed in place on top of my table saw. So the base is a 1/4 inch MDF, but there's a cleat here at the back that keeps it from moving forward. And there are two runners that fit in the miter slots. So the jig itself does not move. As I was making it, I ran it through the table saw in order to put a kerf all the way down to the front of the blade. The blades that I'm using are 7 1/4 inch blades that you would use in circular saws. The reason for that is because they'll give me a 1/16 of an inch kerf and end up giving me more wood out of a hunk than would say an 1/8 of an inch wide thick blade. So after making the kerf in the MDF, I got this wedge-shaped splitter and glued it in place using epoxy. Now the splitter is flat on this side, but on this side it's wedge-shaped, and so it gradually goes from a 1/16 of an inch width at its nose to about 3/8 of an inch at the back end. But the curvature is only on the off-cut side, not on this side. This side is flat and in line with everything else. So 6 inches in length, 3/8 of an inch at the back, the 1/16 of an inch, which matches the blade kerf at the front. In metric, that would be 1.6 millimeters at the front, about a full centimeter at the back, and 15 centimeters full length. Here at the front, there's a fixed fence. Now, it's very important for this thing to work and for it to be safe that the fences stop where the blade starts. So there's a fixed fence glued to the MDF on this side, on the right, and on the left is an adjustable fence that's held in place just with a couple of bolts. And then I use spacers to set the movable fence to whatever width I want. Right now it's set up to give me about 1/8 of an inch sections as they go through the saw. Now, why don't I let my poorly dressed assistant show you the rest of this thing in operation.
Thank you.
So there are three rules to using this jig safely. The first one is to make sure that the workpiece is long enough. And by that, I mean that the workpiece should be fully engaged in the splitter before it leaves the fence. In other words, in this case, the workpiece should be about 14 inches long. So I've allowed a 1-inch overlap from the end of the splitter to the fence. The second rule is, as you're guiding the workpiece through, you can push it against the fence as long as it's making contact with this fence. But once it leaves the fence, before it leaves the fence, your push should be forward, because by that time the splitter will be holding things in place. Okay, this wedge is going to guide the rest of the workpiece into pushing against the fence over here, gently. That's the second rule. The third rule I already mentioned, and that's that the fence should stop before the blade starts. There should be no overlap between the short fence and the blade. I marked the strips so that I can glue them in order with the grain running the same way. This will prevent tear out. To get the rough shape, I soak the strips in room temperature water for about an hour. A length of PVC sewer pipe or downspout or even vacuum pipe with one end capped off makes a good tub. A spring clamp is heavy enough to keep the strips under. Let them dry in rough form until the next day. So in a bent wood lamination, we're going to take thin strips of wood, we're going to clamp them over a form, and the glue in between, once cured, will have them keep the shape that the form gave to them. So what kind of glue should you use to do a bent wood lamination? Well, there's a wide variety of brand name glues that you can choose from, but even a generic PVA will do a pretty good job. The PVAs typically are referred to as yellow glues and white glues. There's lots and lots of examples of them in big box stores. And we're going to choose the white PVA for two very good reasons. The first reason is that the white PVA has a longer open time. Anyone who's attempted a bent wood lamination knows that a long working time is precious. So that's one, that's the biggest reason why we're going to choose the white glue. The lesser reason has to do with its rigidity. So here's a demonstration that I saw at the Ottawa Woodworkers Association. The demonstration was by Karen McBride, one of the better known Ottawa area woodworkers. And what she did was she put a couple of blobs of yellow glue and white glue on some plastic and let them cure. And so I'm going to repeat this demonstration. These have been curing in my shop now for weeks and weeks. So here's the yellow PVA, and what I'm going to try to do is bend it. And you can see that it bends right around, and you can bend it the other way as well. Eventually it'll snap. Now here's the white PVA, and I'll try to bend it as well, and it cracks right away. It's far more rigid than is the yellow PVA, and that rigidity, I'm guessing, is going to keep your structure in place far longer. There'll be no tendency for things to drift apart over the years.